Well, this one's close.
We've got to talk. I've got an ethical dilemma, and so do you. Maybe. One way to attract birds is to play their songs on a smartphone or MP3 player, so they'll come in and check out who the intruder is. Sometimes this works. Sometimes too well. This disturbs the birds. There's no debate about that. There is debate about how much it disturbs the birds and how much is too much. So what are you going to do about it? I went on YouTube and Google to see if there was any consensus about the most responsible ethical way to use audio playbacks on birds. There isn't any. No consensus. Even the American Birding Association Code of Ethics suggests limiting the use of audio on birds rather than total abstinence. My opinion, we don't talk about this enough. In fact, I'm going to give you the debate, and then I'll give you my own personal set of rules, see if any of these fit your circumstances. First, I do use audio in very limited, very specific circumstances, and here's why. I lead walks and tours in the Maine woods. We have thick woods. We have a lot of birds that nest on the ground. This summer, this happened. There are 12 of us staying on the road, and in this spot right here, a dark-eyed junco flashed off a nest right on the shoulder where we were walking. 12 pairs of feet, 24 hiking boots stomping the ground all around this spot where a bird is nesting. Oven birds, Nashville warblers, hermit thrushes, dark-eyed juncos, white-throated sparrows, they're all nesting in the ground right around here. Hermit thrushes are the worst, man. They will nest right out in the middle of a jeep path. So what is the bigger disturbance to a bird? A one-time inconvenience of being lured in by a fake song or stomping that nest forever? What is the ethical thing to do? In this case, the ethical thing to do is stomp the bird nest forever because of rule number one that's coming up. But that's the debate. You can stress a bird by playing audio. You can stress a bird by not playing audio. You're damned if you do, damned if you don't. Bottom line, as an ethical tour leader, I can't have people stomping into the woods off a trail or off a road in circumstances like these. It is better for me to bring out one bird than to go in there and disturb them all. Even if we stomp nothing, we're disturbing the birds in there. Birding is disturbing. If you're interacting with them in some fashion, you are changing their routine in a way that can be distressing, one way or the other. Disturb or don't bird. But not birding leads to not caring. We should care that a billion birds have disappeared from the earth in the last 30 years. We should care that one-third of the animals on Maine's threatened and endangered species list are birds. The impacts we're having on birds in the world is a whole lot worse than disturbing that one bird by playing audio playback. But it is a disturbance. My view, we need more people caring about birds. The more people, the better. A little disturbance is better than a mass extinction. So that's the debate. Audio playbacks can disturb birds. It can stress a male who's trying to defend a territory. Evidence indicates they get increased hormone levels, more agitation. If they get lured away from a nest, they may not defend the nest so well. Predation, parasitism can happen when the nest is undefended. So when you're drawing in birds away from what they should be defending, that can be bad. The other side of the debate, inconveniencing one bird is better for the environment and for the birds than disturbing the whole woodlot. When I use audio with a group, I want them to see the bird, but more importantly, I want them to stay on the road and the path. I really don't want to do any more damage than I'm already doing. Is that just rationalization? Probably. When I'm out birding by myself, I seldom use audio. In fact, I rarely even bring my MP3 player when I'm by myself. I will bring my smartphone, but only because it has my Sibley app on it, and it's got Merlin, which I like to use in the field. Mostly just to see if I can trick it. I'm like that. So when I'm out birding or leading a tour, I have 10 rules I follow about when to use audio and when not to. You can use any of these or not use any of these. It's your personal code of ethics. Do what you want. Number one rule, where it's prohibited, don't do it. National parks, national monuments, prohibited. National wildlife refuge, prohibited. The law and the rule don't exactly say that. What it actually says is, it's prohibited to disturb or distress wildlife. And the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service says playing audio distresses wildlife, therefore prohibited. In fact, anywhere U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has jurisdiction, that rule holds prohibited. What's a little weird is that pishing, you know, imitating a chickadee to draw in a mob, psh, 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 well, that's okay. Imitating an owl, that's okay. So what's most commonly done on the East, screech owl is popular, people imitate northern saw-whet owl, barred owl sometimes. In the west, northern pygmy owl tends to be the owl of choice. If you can imitate it, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service says that's okay. So let me get this straight. Disturbing one bird is bad, but disturbing the entire woodlot of birds is okay. That's just splitting hairs. You bet it is. But frankly, that's what regulations and laws do. They split hairs. It's 74 miles an hour is okay, 76 miles an hour is breaking the law. In Maine, if you have a brook trout of 6 inches, you can keep it. If it's 5 7/8 inches and you keep it, you're breaking the law. Yeah, that's what law does. It just splits hairs. Rule number two, don't do it on rare, threatened, sensitive, out of range birds. Don't do it. By definition, these birds are stressed enough already. Leave them alone. Plus, if it's an out of range bird in a known location, it's likely other people are taping this bird and you don't want to add to the stress, so I just don't do it. Number three, don't do it in popular places. You know, city park, nature trail, any place where other people may be taping the birds as well. That can disturb the birds when they get taped over and over by different people coming through. So in a popular place, I don't do it. I will only do it in an area where I think no taper has been before or is coming after. I will say this rule is a judgment call, and sometimes my judgment isn't perfect. Sometimes I probably do err on the side of letting people see a cool bird. Rule number four, don't do the same birds over and over. If you're going on consecutive walks over multiple days, alternate where you stop. Don't stress the same birds, even if no one's ever gonna go back and tape them again. In fact, I gotta tell you, if I'm leading a walk for a festival one day and somebody's leading it the next day, I'm gonna be pretty judicious about what I'm doing so that I'm not creating multiple disturbances. Number five, and this is kind of a funny one, don't do it around other people. Is there anything worse than be leading a bird walk and you hear a really cool bird and you try to get everybody on it and you walk around the corner and there's somebody taping? Or you're just in a pleasure walk by yourself and you hear a cool bird and you want to go see it and somebody else is taping for it. Rule number six, let the bird win. I think this is the most important rule of the bunch. If you're gonna do it, don't overdo it. Let the bird win. If you get into a singing contest with a bird, make sure that you stop before he does. In fact, long before he does. Look, I don't need to give everybody in my group a perfect look. If the bird comes in, shows itself, try to see it because I'm not gonna do this for long. It's a little bit strange, but there is some scientific indication that if a bird wins a singing contest, he's even more likely to go copulate immediately afterwards. And the female he's with may be impressed. Let the bird win. Obviously, the shorter you can do it, the better. But one good rule of thumb is, a lot of times the bird will come in to investigate the intruder and look for it. If he can't find the intruder, he's likely to just go to one spot and start to try to sing it away. Now you're in a singing contest. Abbreviate that, lose, leave. Number seven, don't draw in females. If I'm trying to bring in a bird and a female comes in, I'm done. If it's nesting season and you pull a female in, she may have left that nest unprotected and bad things can happen. If I see a female, I'm done. Of course, in some species that aren't noted for their faithfulness, a female coming in to check out the sexy new singer may get herself in trouble another way. Number eight, don't use a predator. This one is going to be questioned by some people because mobbing tapes are popular. You get an owl calling and a whole bunch of small birds come around to mob it and that chatter draws other birds in, right? And usually it's the same owls, northern pygmy owl out west, screech owl, northern saw-whet owl. Those get used popularly. I don't. When I see other people do it, I note more females coming in, for instance, and I see much more agitation in the birds. Actually, I use my own special mix. I put together years ago black-capped chickadee, red-breasted nuthatch, American robin, and tufted titmouse into this little mix I call chickadee cacophony. When I play this, I find the birds come in out of curiosity more than fear. They don't suspect a predator, they just want to know what's going on. And the funny thing is, when birds come into this, they're mostly curious. They don't even alter their behavior. They're still up there foraging where they're looking around out of curiosity. And I almost never bring in a female with it. So I personally like this mix. I've used it for years. The key point is, no predator in it. Number nine, don't start a fight. If you recognize you've got two males singing on territory not far apart from each other, they've got that territory pretty well defined. If you step in the middle, play a tape, you can draw them both into conflict with each other. Oven birds are the worst. If I hear two males singing relatively close to each other, I will avoid the fight. Don't bring them in. Remember, they've just heard what they think is a competitor. They come in to check him out, and they see the other male, and they're going to ignore you. They're going at it. Number 10, do watch behavior. You can tell the difference between a bird that is seriously agitated versus one that's just mildly curious. Some birds are just instinctively unconcerned. Magnolia warblers, American redstarts, they usually ignore you. Maybe a brief period of the year, they might get a little interested. Other than that, you're nothing to them. I find that black and white warblers have a short attention span. I find that closely related species can have very different behaviors. Yellow-bellied flycatcher comes in. Alder flycatcher ignores you. Olive-sided flycatcher comes in. Great-crested flycatcher could care less. Eastern phoebes won't. Eastern wood peewees will. Your experience may vary. The point is, watch behavior. If you're leading a group, knowing how the bird's going to behave ahead of time can shorten the amount of time you actually have to impact the bird. For instance, some birds come right in, northern Perula, black-throated green warbler. They come just right in, chestnut-sided warbler comes right in and looks at you. Ovenbird, northern water thrush, Nashville warbler, they have a tendency to circle around you while they're trying to find the intruder. In fact, they will cross the road several times. Let the group know they're going to do that, they'll get on it much faster, and you can quit much quicker. Black-throated blue warblers are shy. They actually come in kind of quietly and stare around for the intruder. They may even sing, but in a soft voice until they get their courage back. I go easy on them. Morning warblers. They will circle around looking for the intruder, trying to stay out of sight. But they call, constantly telling you where they are. It's amusing, and you can use that with a group so they get on it faster and you can leave. Some birds that live in grasslands and marshes are talking to each other all the time to make sure they keep an appropriate distance from each other's territories because they can't see each other down there. In these cases, rails, marsh wrens, swamp sparrows, if you're too close, they will come and investigate you, sure, but then you know when to stop. It's kind of hard to disturb these birds because they're already talking to each other all the time. You're just part of the conversation. You may elicit a response and a chance for them to come out and look around, but they're used to squabbling just to keep their territory separate in an area where they can't see each other very well. Nelson sparrow in the wetlands along the main coast, that can be a hard bird to see, except when they're part of a conversation, they pop up to the top of the grass, and you can just pick out that little shadow out there and get a good look. You may be a disturbance, but you're a pretty mild one. Again, the point is, if you know what birds are going to do as a reaction, you can alert your group so they know what to look for, and you can shorten your interaction with the bird. Ultimately, getting other people excited about birds is one of the primary justifications for using audio. Yeah, maybe it is a rationalization, but it's not a bad one. I agree with the ABA Code of Ethics. If you must do it as limited as possible. Ultimately, this is about all of us having our own personal code of ethics. Your views may differ. Your rules may differ. Feel free to put those in the comment section below. We don't have this discussion enough, but now we are. Thanks.